Well, good morning, church.
Good morning, Steve.
It's great to see you all here as live brothers and sisters in Christ. And a very good morning to our Zoomers. It is great that you are joining us as well. Well, this morning we are continuing with our series, Hard But Helpful Sayings of Jesus. And we'll be hearing from Craig later in his sermon. Before we begin our service, let's bow our heads in prayer. Lord Jesus, we thank you that we can come here to pray, praise, and to hear from your word. We pray that as we honour your name, that we grow to be more like you, and we will be more receptive in hearing your word and to listen to your holy songs of God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to be listening to our first song, a great hymn, Praise My Soul, the King and of Heaven. Stand and declare our praise to God as it comes on the screen. Together, you are worthy, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honour and power, for you created all things, and by your will you were created and have their being. You are worthy, Lamb of God, for you were slain, and with your blood you ransomed people for God. And for every tribe and language and people and nation, you have made them to be a kingdom and priests to serve our God, and they will reign with you on earth. To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and honour and glory and power forever and ever. Amen. If you remain standing, we're going to affirm our faith together. Christians, who do you believe? with all Christians everywhere. We believe in one God who made everything. The Father sent his Son to die on the cross. Jesus rose again as Lord of all, that we may live forever with him. God sent his Holy Spirit to live in us, that we may grow more like Jesus. Amen. Please be seated. We're going to be hearing from God's word together. Before we do this, let us pray the scriptures will be delivered to us. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for inspiring all scripture by the Holy Spirit. By your Spirit, help us to hear your holy word, that we might be equipped for every good work through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. As I prepare to read Job 1, I invite Kathy and Steve to take the children to their growing together time. If you can look up in your Bibles to Job 1, verse 6 to 12, or you can look on the screen. One day the angels came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came with them. The Lord said to Satan, "Where have you come from?" Satan answered the Lord, "From roaming throughout the earth, going back and forth on it." Then the Lord said to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job? There is no one on earth like him. He is blameless and upright, a man who fears God and shuns evil." "Does Job fear God for nothing?" Satan replied. "Have you not put a hedge around him and his household and everything he has? You have blessed the work of his hands so that his flocks and herds are spread throughout the land. But now stretch out your hand and strike everything he has, and he will surely curse you to your face." The Lord said to Satan, "Very well then, everything he has in your power, but on the man himself do not lay a finger." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Our second reading is from Matthew chapter 10, verses 24 to 33. That's Matthew chapter 10, verses 24 to 33. The student is not above the teacher, nor a servant above his master. It is enough for students to be like their teachers and servants like their masters. If the head of the house has been called Beelzebub, how much more the members of his household? So do not be afraid of them, for there is nothing concealed that will not be disclosed, or hidden that will not be made known. What I tell you in the dark, speak in the daylight. What is whispered in your ear, proclaim from the roofs. Do not be afraid of those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather, be afraid of the one who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground outside your Father's care. And even the very hairs of your head are all numbered. So, do not be afraid. You are worth more than many sparrows. Whoever acknowledges me before others, I will also acknowledge before my Father in heaven. But whoever disowns me before others, I will disown before my Father in heaven. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Consider Christ the source of our salvation. should take the penalty for me. Though he was pure, a lamb without a blemish, he took my sins and nailed them to the tree. My Lord.
Certainly great to be with you here this morning, and hi to the Zoomers and also anybody who's watching later on. If you don't know who I am, my name's Craig. I'm the senior minister here, and it's great to be with you here today. Now, if you've got a Bible there, you may like to open to Matthew chapter 10. Today is more of a topical sermon looking at a few different passages, but Matthew chapter 10 will have the main point which will come to us today, God willing. And you might like to have some paper or some pens there to help as you hear the word today. And so with that, all that preliminary stuff out of the way, let us now pray together. Dear Father, we thank you so much that you've brought us here today. We pray now that your living word will do its work in our lives by your Holy Spirit. Father, please use this word to further transform us, so that we are more like your Son, full of faith, hope, and love. And we ask in the name of Jesus, Amen. Well, recently there was a show on TV called Big Brother, and there'll be a slide coming up about that very soon. And in it, there's about 20 housemates that go into a house, and Big Brother sees almost everything that is done. Now, the winner of this show was a guy called Chad. And the new reality for him will always be, from now on, the Big Brother winner from 2020. And not sure if you know it, but Chad is local to here. And the other day, I saw a car that he bought. Now, having won the prize, his life has changed, and part of what he did was buy a car. Now, I know he bought a car because I saw it in our street. He used to live in our street. And I was driving out, I saw the car, and I saw Chad. And so I waved to him, and he recognized me, and he waved back. Oh, so exciting. The Big Brother winner recognized me. But, and I'm sure you'd agree, there's something even bigger and better than winning Big Brother. And something even better and bigger than knowing the person that won Big Brother. And that, of course, the great joy it is and the reality it is to be a child of God. The great joy to know we are forgiven. The great new reality we have as we turn to Jesus as Lord, that we are adopted into God's family. God's Spirit is with us forever, a great promise for the future in the new creation. God's with us every step of the way, a wonderful new reality as Christians. And with this new reality we have in Christ, there is perhaps what we might call a darker side to that as well. And that is the fact, as part of our reality as Christians, is that we have an enemy. An enemy. Make no mistake, even as I speak, as we're here today, we have an enemy, the devil. 1 Peter 5, verse 8. Be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. The devil, the slanderer, the accuser, is there wanting to destroy our faith. And even as we speak today, picture the devil around about us, seeking, looking for someone to devour. He's doing all he can to destroy our faith. He's doing all that he can to make us deny Christ. He's behind persecution. He's behind false teaching. He's behind everything that tries to get us to go away from Christ as Lord. And it's within this context of opposition that we have our next in our series of hard but helpful sayings of Jesus. Bit of homework. Bit of testing from last week. Who can remember the image that we've got for this whole series of four sermons? Those at 8:30 could remember. Is there somebody here that can remember? A cold shower, that's right. Now, if you weren't here last week, you might remember I actually had a cold shower Friday a week ago. Cold showers are hard, particularly on a cold morning, but they're helpful. They really wake you up. And last week was our first in this series. And can anybody remember what's the image that Jesus talked about in Luke 12, or Luke 13, his parable that he told? Fig tree, thank you. It's a barren fig tree. And remember in the parable, the fig tree had one more year left. If it bear fruit, good. If not, it was going to be cut down. It was a warning. A warning for all of us in the end. All to repent now, or perish. Perish being, after death, being thrown into hell. Judgment day is coming. Repent. And someone helpfully asked me after the service last week, what does repentance look like? And here's an image which I trust will help. Repentance means that you turn to Christ. You turn and away from yourself in charge, but Jesus is in charge. A U-turn, a change of our mind and our thinking. And that's lived out then day by day. It's a daily walk of repentance with Jesus as Lord, turning from self-rule to Jesus' rule. And that'll express itself in faith, hope, and love, the three marks of the Christian. And all that comes, of course, from the Scriptures, from the Bible. And today, we move on to our second in our series of hard but helpful sayings of Jesus. Now, I couldn't think of one image to summarize it, so I've got three today. And here is the saying. Courageously confess Christ or perish. Courageously confess Christ or perish. Now, as we unpack that, there's both a word of encouragement, but there's a warning as well. And with it also comes this word of encouragement that Christ, through prayer and promises, enables us. Courageously confess Christ or perish. And Christ, through prayer and promises, enables us to do that. Now, this is a hard saying. Hard saying in the sense that it is difficult to do. Because when we're under pressure for being a Christian, it is tempting, it can be tempting, it will be tempting to give up on Jesus. And this happens. Remember, Jesus told the story of the soils. The second soil, the shallow soil, the seed fell in, sprang up, the heat come out, was hot, and they shriveled and died. And Jesus says that represents those people who receive the word of God, believe it, but when opposition comes, they wither and die because they've got no root. See, it's hard to stand firm for Christ. And in our country, it's getting even harder to do that. Persecution is on the rise. And of course, in many other countries around the world, there's been heavy persecution for a long time. It's hard to courageously confess Christ. But this is also a helpful saying because Jesus leaves us in no doubt as to what our response is to be. We're not left in the dark. Very clear on what our response is to be. And it's also helpful, I trust, because we are very clear on the context of this saying as well. Very clear or reminded about the enemy that is about us. It's good to know your enemy, isn't it? What he's trying to do. And the Bible is clear that we do have this enemy. That's our first point. In Genesis 3, Satan was there tempting Adam and Eve. In the book of Job, we see the Lord allows Satan to tempt Job. Job's unaware of what's going on, but Satan's at work there. Jesus was tempted by the devil and his disciples as well. In Luke 22, we find this. Luke 22, verse 31. Simon, Simon, Jesus says, Satan has asked to sift all of you, disciples, as wheat. So in sifting and going towards Simon Peter, all the disciples are being tempted and tested. The you means all the disciples. Trying to sift, trying to work out, are they true disciples? And early on, Jesus had said to his disciples in Matthew 10, all people will hate you because of me. And behind that stands Satan. So in this context of opposition, of pressure to deny Christ, comes this call to courageously confess Christ or perish. And the particular verses where this comes out is in Matthew 10, verse 32 and 33, where Jesus says, whoever acknowledges me before others, I will also acknowledge before my Father in heaven. But whoever disowns me before others, I will disown before my Father in heaven. There's both a positive and a negative statement here. The positive is in verse 32, where Jesus says, if anybody courageously confesses me as Lord, sticks up for me, stands by me, come judgment day, I will also acknowledge them before my Father. They'll be in the eternal kingdom. That's the positive thing, the encouragement. As we courageously confess Christ as King, we are saved. But the negative, verse 33, if we disown Christ, if we deny Christ, if we say, I'm not a believer, then come judgment day, Christ will also disown us. We won't be in the eternal kingdom. We will perish. So this is a life or death matter. Very serious matter. Acknowledge Christ, he'll acknowledge us. We deny him, he will deny us. So we need to courageously confess Christ or we will perish. Hear the word of encouragement. Hear the word of warning as well. Now, let me describe five situations which are examples of where there is pressure to deny Christ, where we need to make a choice. Now, this is five of many scenarios. Eddie, your workmate, says to you, "Hey, Fred, what did you do on the weekend?" Now, at that point, we have a choice, don't we? What do we say? Do we mention church? Yvonne, your friend, says to you, "Hey, Sally, I'm really feeling fearful in this COVID season. I need some peace. My heart is restless. And I've stumbled on some stuff about Buddhism. And it talks about offering me peace. I've begun to look into it, and I feel a bit better. What do you think about Buddhism stuff?" What do you say at that point? Or your child or your grandchild comes home from school, or your great-grandchild, and is in tears. And you ask, what's wrong? And they say, I've got no friends anymore because I believe in Jesus. And I go to scripture, I come to church. I don't want to be a Christian anymore because it's just too hard. What do you say to your child or your grandchild? A number of years ago, Sandra and I went to a baptism of a friend's child of ours. And at the lunch, can't remember all the details, it's a while ago now, but the conversation was going along the lines of God, which is perhaps not surprising, it was a baptism. But this person said they thought that all the different religions were kind of different ways to the one God. All the different faiths led to the same place in the end, so it didn't really matter what you believed. Every religion was okay. What and how should Sandra, what should we say? How should we respond? Well, the last scenario, you're led by God to another country to serve, and it's a Muslim country. You get to the border and they ask you, "Why are you here? Are you a Christian?" What do you say? Well, the call here is to courageously confess Christ or perish. The call is not to fear those around us, which Matthew 10, Jesus says there, they can only kill the body. Don't fear those. Fear the one who after death can kill both body and soul in hell. So we're called to courageously confess Christ. So I quickly go through the scenarios as possible ways to confess Christ there. You say to Eddie, your workmate, "Yeah, I went to church and it was great. We sang, we prayed, we heard a talk, etc." You say to your friend Sally, you say, "That's really interesting. You know what? I understand we need peace, don't we? Buddhism might give you peace for this life, but the Jesus I know, the Lord, he promises peace both now and forever. Would you like to hear about Jesus?" What do you say to your child, grandchild, or great-grandchild who doesn't want to be a Christian anymore because it's hard? You give them a big cuddle. And you say, "How blessed you are." Because Jesus says, you're blessed. It's a good thing to be persecuted because Matthew 5, yours is the kingdom of heaven. It's a sign you're in God's kingdom. How blessed you are because great is your reward in heaven. Again, Matthew 5. You share with them the blessing of persecution. And you give them this, show them this passage as well from Matthew chapter 10. And with thanks to God, we spoke up at that lunch and said something along the lines of, "Well, we're Christians, we respectfully disagree. Jesus says there's one God and he's the only way to God." Now, there were no fisticuffs at that barbecue or whatever we're having. But there was a bit of tension there, of course. And if you're led somewhere else to serve, you're asked, "Are you a Christian?" You've got to say, yes, I am. Yes, we are. We're here to serve God, here to serve Jesus, irrespective of the consequences. See, we don't fear those who can just kill us or hurt us. We fear the one who after death can throw body and soul, destroy body and soul in hell, as Matthew 10 tells us. So this need to courageously confess Christ. But you might be thinking, why on earth is there this need? Why isn't it okay just to be sort of casually committed to Christ and deny and sort of know, Jesus is saying? Because in the end, what we speak or don't speak shows our heart. It shows Jesus wants us to know who are really his people. And it's true about anything, isn't it? Whatever has got our heart, we speak about. So if you love cricket like I do, I look for opportunities to speak about cricket. Or if you love gardening, you speak about gardening. Or if you love your family, you speak about your family. If you hate your family, you'll speak about your family. Whatever's got your heart, you'll speak about. And over the years, I've known lots of quiet people, including myself. Very hard sometimes to get a word out of them. But if you find their passion, they'll speak and speak and speak. Now, it's not a criticism. It's just how we are. Whatever has gripped our heart, we speak about. If Jesus has got our heart, we're gripped by his love and grace and kindness, we'll speak about him. We'll courageously confess him. See, we show by our speech whether we truly are believers or not, particularly when things are tough. When things are difficult to be a Christian, the true Christians will stand up. Those who are casually committed, they won't. But there's a question worth thinking about here. Will we perish if we once off deny Christ? Like we say this morning, yep, we're going to courageously confess Christ, but then you do, under pressure. You do fear those people around you. Is that it? Is it one strike and you're gone? How can we be courageous? Well, let's look at the example of Peter and see what happened here. So we're in Luke 22, verse 31. Jesus speaking. Simon, Simon, Satan has asked to sift all of you as wheat. But I have prayed for you, Simon, that your faith may not fail. And when you have turned back, strengthen your brothers. But he replied, Lord, I am ready to go with you to prison and to death. Jesus answered, I tell you, Peter, before the rooster crows today, you will deny three times that you know me. Peter here is full of bravado. Yeah, Jesus, I won't deny you. I'm going to stick with you, even to death. But that day, he does deny Jesus. Read on about 30-odd verses. Now, Peter knew what Jesus said earlier. If you deny me, I'll deny you. He was close to spiritual suicide by his denial. But he did it. And the rooster crowed. We pick it up at verse 61. The Lord turned and looked straight at Peter. Then Peter remembered the word the Lord had spoken to him. Before the rooster crows today, you will disown me three times. And he went outside and wept bitterly. That penetrating look from Jesus, and he breaks down and weeps. No more bravado, deep sorrow because of what has happened. And it's the beginning of Peter turning back to Jesus. If you keep reading through the gospel accounts, and for example, come to John 21, you see Jesus reinstates Peter. He gives him a job. And so this morning, let's be encouraged by that. A one-off denial doesn't mean you're out. It's not one strike and you're out. if in the moment of pressure you do deny Jesus in some situation. So that's very different if you're thinking this way. If you're thinking, oh, I will deny Jesus if it gets tough. Yeah, I like Jesus, but if I get persecuted for Jesus, I'm going to give up. If you're thinking like that, or someone on Zoom's thinking like that, or someone who watches the recording is thinking like this, hear the warning from Jesus today. If you deny Jesus like that, then come Judgment Day, Jesus will deny you. See, we want to be courageous, don't we? We want to confess Christ and not deny him. But how do we do it? How do we do it? How can we be courageous? How can we help each other be courageous for Christ? Let's look at how Peter got through. And it's this way. Christ, through prayer and promises, enables us. How do we courageously confess Christ as King? Well, Christ, through prayer and promises, enables us. How did Peter get through? Well, Jesus prayed for him. Verse 31, Luke 22 again. Simon, Simon, Satan has asked to sift all of you as wheat. But I have prayed for you, Simon, that your faith may not fail. How did Peter cope? It wasn't his own strength. How did Peter survive? Only because the Son of God interceded for him. That's the only reason Peter survived Satan's sifting. And in saving Peter, Jesus saved us as well. In saving Peter, Jesus was saving us as well. Because look what Jesus then says. And when you have turned back, strengthen your brothers. So it's not if you turn back, help your fellow believers, maybe. When you turn back, strengthen your brothers. See, Jesus is saying to Peter, I'm going to use you to help fellow believers stand firm for Christ. I'm going to use you so they don't deny Christ like you've just done. I'm going to strengthen them. And we see in 1 Peter 5 all these points coming together where... And if you read through the book of Acts and the 1 and 2 Peter, Jesus has been using those to strengthen his people. Peter's been strengthening fellow believers for over 2,000 years. And I'm sure Peter had no idea that was going to happen at that point. And as Peter is strengthening us, it's actually Jesus who's strengthening us because he's the Apostle Peter. When Peter speaks, Jesus speaks. Or when any apostle speaks, it's Jesus speaking. And this reminder here, we have this enemy, verse 9, resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that the family of believers throughout the world is undergoing the same kind of sufferings. Like, stand firm, courageously confess Christ. Christians everywhere are persecuted, and that's true, isn't it? Stand firm. How do we do that? Verse 10, and the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, will himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. How do we be strong in Christ? Courageously confess him. We don't look to ourselves for strength. We look to God, who promises to strengthen us. And in Matthew 10, Jesus talks about the Heavenly Father knows about the sparrows. He looks after them. And we're worth more than sparrows. He'll look after us. He even knows how many hairs you have on your head. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid of persecution that we will face. God will strengthen us. So we keep preaching Christ here from the front and individually confessing Christ. Don't be afraid. And so, dear brothers and sisters in Christ, hear this hard but helpful saying of Jesus. Courageously confess Christ. And as we do that, come Judgment Day, Christ will acknowledge us and welcome us in. Be encouraged by that, but also hear the warning that if we deny Christ, we will perish. And hear that word of encouragement that Christ, through prayer and promises, enables us to courageously confess Christ. Remember, in saving Peter, Jesus was saving us. In saving Peter, Jesus was saving us. Let us pray. Dear Father, we thank you for this word of encouragement, for this word of warning. And Father, we are sorry when we've denied Christ, when there have been times when we should have spoken up, but we were quiet. Father, give us strength for the next time to courageously confess Christ, to know that you're with us. We have nothing, no one to fear. And Father, we look forward to that day when Christ will welcome us into his eternal kingdom. And we ask in Jesus' name, Amen. And now Simon will lead us in further prayer.
Well, I have the privilege of leading us in further prayer this morning. We're going to begin with a confession because it's appropriate that we confess our sins to the Lord. That's how we are forgiven, by confessing our sins, forgiven through Christ. So let's pray this prayer together. Heavenly Father, we praise you for adopting us as your children and making us heirs of eternal life. In your mercy, you have washed us from our sins and made us clean in your sight. Yet we still fail to love you and serve you as we should. Forgive us our sins and renew us by your grace, that we may continue to grow as members of Christ, in whom alone is our salvation. Amen. And the promise is this: the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation for all people. God, therefore, forgives you through Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all wickedness and to purify for himself a people that are his very own, eager to do what is good. Amen. The Operation World Country this morning is the Maldives. Now, I confess I never heard of this country before, but it's quite astonishing what it is like for Christians in this country. They are the minority. Now, the Maldives is near Sri Lanka. Now, 99% of this population is Muslim. And so if you are a Christian there, you have to courageously confess Christ, don't you? Now, more about this nation. Its people are considered the least evangelized nation on earth. Mission work and Christian literature has never been allowed. The government denies the existence of Christianity while arresting those who believe. The perception of Christianity is very bad, largely due to Western media and tourist immorality. Political opponents use the term Christian to slander other people. Persecution of believers is intense. Christians can expect mockery, ostracism, torture, and numerous other things as well. So let's pray for this country together now. Heavenly Father, we bring before you the Maldivian people, and ask that you will make it possible for them to know the true name and character of Jesus. We pray that the state's contradictions and heavy heaviness towards Christianity will generate great curiosity and be used for your purposes in bringing people to faith in you. For the small minority who believe, we pray for their protection, their courage in the face of great trials, and for opportunities to grow in the spread of the faith throughout this nation. We ask that you would strengthen those who are seeking to bring your gospel to this nation. And if you are calling us to serve there, please make that clear to us as well. And we ask all this in the name of Jesus, our Lord and Saviour. Amen. Let's continue to pray for other things now as well. Heavenly Father, we again thank you and praise you today that we can call you our Heavenly Father. We praise you that you loved the world so much that you sent your one and only Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. Lord, you know and see the suffering that's happening in our world at the moment. And you hear the cry of the afflicted, the vulnerable, the poor, and the lonely. Please, Father, have mercy on our world, and may your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We pray you will bring an end to the pandemic that is happening, that you will heal and comfort those who are suffering, that you will bring a vaccine and a cure for this virus. And ultimately, Lord, we pray that you will use this virus to bring many people to faith in you, to repentance and salvation. Father, we pray for governments all around the world, our national government and our state leaders. We pray that they can be making wise and just decisions for the good of all, for citizens to submit to the authority for the good of all. And we all pray for wisdom in these times. Please help our governments and please help all our citizens to be humble and obedient to your word and truth. And may you continue to soften all people's hearts and minds in this time. Help us as your people to be the light of the world, a light to our families and communities and people around us, pointing people to Jesus each day. Please give us that boldness and courage that we've heard about today to not disown you, but to courageously confess that you are Christ is Lord, no matter the cost or how hard it is. We pray, Lord, for the gospel work here at Eagle Vale to bear much fruit. And we ask that you'll continue to bless and strengthen the work here in the Bible studies, in church services, in primary and high school scripture, our weekly missional communities, including ESL, Mobile Pantry, Karate, Sorted Group, and Trivia. We pray that Little Lambs will eventually resume as well. Please also strengthen and embolden us all for sharing our faith again with many people around us. And we pray for Kevin and Mandy this weekend as they're doing that, as they catch up with some friends. It will help them to do that as well. Father, we're being reminded today in your scripture as well that if one sparrow falls to the ground, that doesn't happen apart from your will. You care for that sparrow and you care for us as your people. And so, Lord, you know those of us that are suffering and in need at the moment, those that are in need of healing. And so, Lord, we think of those people this morning that we know that are suffering physically, mentally, and emotionally. We pray for healing. We pray for perseverance. We pray for your sustaining grace. And we pray for trust and comfort for our brothers and sisters in this time. We pray that your grace will be sufficient for them, and that you'll strengthen them in their weakness. Help them to trust in you, and help others we know that are suffering. We pray that they will trust in you, and equip us to love and support our brothers and sisters in this time. God, we thank you for the money that has been given through the offertory as well, both online and via envelopes. And thank you for moving our hearts to be generous. Please help us to continue to be good stewards of the money that you have entrusted us with for your work and glory. And again, we thank you for the privilege it is to pray and know that you listen to our prayers. And thank you for the promise that you answer our prayers according to your wills and purposes. And we pray all this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you, Simon. As we go out to serve this day, there's a few announcements this morning. The first is that it's okay to not be okay. If you're struggling in any way, please come and chat with me after the service. I'll be out in the foyer. Or if you're online, give me a call on 0400 681099. That's 0400 681099. Or go to the website, send me an email. And please don't forget the offertory box over there near the window. And I would like now to invite Steve, who has an announcement.
Good morning, everyone. Well, I just would like to take the opportunity just to remind us all about our newish community outreach that we've got happening, our community online trivia. There's a couple of things I believe needs to happen for any outreach to be successful. Firstly is for God's hand to be involved with it. And secondly, it also needs God's church to get behind it as well. So along those lines, I'd just like to let everyone know that this coming Friday, we'll be having our community trivia again online via Zoom. We have it every second and fourth Friday. And usually on the Wednesday or Thursday before, Sashi will get onto our EVAC Facebook page and put a link and an advertisement up for it. It would be really, really helpful if you're on Facebook, if you could jump on there, like the post, share it, and invite some friends to come along and maybe even join in yourself as well. We go from 7 o'clock to 8 o'clock, and it's a lot of fun. We have some laughs, we enjoy ourselves, and we only announce the top two or three place getters. So if you feel like you're a bit of a dud when it comes to trivia, that's all right. We don't publicly shame anyone for coming last or getting a bad score. We would just very much like to have you involved, for you to also invite your friends. And while Sashi is adding up the final score for the night, I give a 2-minute short little gospel talk. I try to make it very accessible to people that are non-Christians as well as Christians. And then we announce the winners at the end. So I would love you to be involved. If you have any questions about it, please let me know. Or if you see Sashi around, you can ask her as well. Thank you.
A number of folk give their apologies this morning. Some getting COVID tested, families and individuals. So I want to pass that on. And can I encourage us, after our more formal time, we can speak to each other, but do so sitting down. Or you may want to, out in the foyer, you want to have a chat with me, we can discuss things there. Or you may want to go outside into the car park across the road or invite each other back to your place for lunch or something like that. And now I would like to invite George. And Georgia, just to add, not just, but I want to add, on behalf of the staff and the whole church, we thank God for you and how God's been at work in you and through you over this almost 5 years. And so we look forward to. Well, there is no other name by which we must be saved, and that's our last song. This is the name that we courageously confess. Christ is Lord. No other name. Thank you.
Thank you.
cast our fears, no other name but Jesus.
Great for us to be here this morning, and as we conclude our time together, let us pray to our Father to take us out by the Spirit. Together, Father, take us and use us to love and serve you and all people in the power of your Spirit and in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. Have a good morning.